the item bank, which is the assessment fund.
So those are the two things that we're gonna concentrate on this year. We've asked the principals, as you know, we got a grant, $57,000, to train our trainers.
And so in July, we have to pay, July 26th, we have to train the trainers on a piece with the lesson planner and the assessment bank. And they will be required to go back in July, I mean, in August, when the teachers get there and do this training for the teachers in their school. And this will be an ongoing.
Opens up, we will bring those trainers back in throughout the year. They will be trained again, and they will go back and train their school. So they will be paid a stipend for the year to be able to get this rolled out to each school individually. Trying to roll it out to the whole district, we felt like it would be difficult.
And we felt like they had good trainers in each school, so they sent the name of the trainer that they thought would come and would train. So throughout the year, next year, they will be doing this, and probably this will continue for the next 3 years, because this scope of work agreement that we have covers three years. So as things roll out, we'll be coming back, and I can do that. I will be somebody.
This is great, this is gonna be a big thing for teachers to say that. And so I'm excited, I think once we get started this year, we'll see, we can talk about it, and we'll see more kids in use.
Right now, we just wanna make sure everybody has the same message and across the district and knew how to use it, so that's what our education. Do you have any questions?
Superintendents were trained on it last week at the Kentucky Association of School Superintendents. All the superintendents have been trained on it as well. And it's $57,000 as part of that Race at the Top grant. But we didn't get to decide how to use it. They told us this is how it was gonna honest. So it's worked out. This is gonna be probably one of the state-of-the-art pieces of technology across the state when they get it fully implemented. But the challenge is gonna be to ensure that we train all of our teachers and that they're using it. So we're gonna have to make sure we're monitoring it to make sure that they're using it. There's a lot of great stuff on here that will make teaching and learning for them a lot more effective and efficient. So the key is gonna make sure that we support our teachers in using this tool. Because oftentimes we get great technology if we don't use it. So our goal now, Jeff, is that we make sure that we train the teachers so they're comfortable with using this piece of technology. It's gonna be great.
Thank you very much. The next, our overview of summer maintenance projects, Mr. Christie.
Send you a copy of what we announced that we took prior to the end of school. We asked all principals and custodial folks in the Houston building to give us a list of items in the building that they wanted to address this summer. We were fortunate this year, we had good weather, that helped our maintenance budget tremendously. We worked hard in the custodial supply area, doing some very competitive bidding. Savings there than we have in years past. And you work hard and that enabled us to take on a lot more of these things that you see on this list. I tell you that everything that's on the list has a start and complete date with 90% finish time. We just put the start and stop date on there. And, I mean, that's again, that's through the line in the sand with the maintenance guys. They know it has to be done by a certain time. And this is something that we'll continue. And I'm looking at how we can do this with general maintenance items throughout the year, or something about having a dead eye on there. They work extremely hard, even with the heat. They've had some good days to this last couple weeks. Everyone, these guys got after and done an excellent job. I think we're going to be able to actually kick off some things. If we don't have start and stop days, we'll be meeting in a few days. We're going to add some additional start and stop days on this running items. Pick up on this, even in the new year's don't want any safety issues anywhere. Regardless of how long the school's going to be in use, this safety comes first. That's a huge sidewalk, it's like a tough sidewalk. We're looking at repair, the change will come in, we'll cut out the section of damage and just replace that part. And it's good, that's one of those things we're looking to pick up and try and build for school park.
It's hard.
That's one of those safety issues.
It's a huge section, yes.
It is. It's right, very simple.
Other questions to Mr. Kuska about any projects?
All of these items, too, are a lot of these items, are this maintenance repair plan. We sit down and say, before we start even giving them input in the principal, we look at maintenance repair plan. We start pulling items off that and that's where they start. And then they'll add up to the info out of the principal and it sends back, they add additional things to that. That things could come up potentially within the maintenance repair plan, so we kind of involve.
Hi, Mr. Kuska. Just got a couple of things. We were found out today that Van Bush and Shear School did receive the Fresh Fruits and Vegetables Grant for the 2012-2013 school year. And we know that that's a national program. And the whole purpose of that program is to change the efforts in combating childhood obesity, helping children learn more healthful eating habits. So these fruits and vegetables will be a part of snacks that they can choose from. We got the grant last year, so we're excited that we were awarded the grant again this year for Fannie Bush and Shear Elementary Schools. Update on council training. We have all of our council members in place. And we have already started their training for them. We just have a few that have not gotten their training done, but it will be done. Hopefully, which the state law says that they have 30 days by which to get their training done. So we'll continue to work on. Just a few have not been able to do that because of vacations and what have you. Also, we have completed the migration of our new software to the cloud. That is a KDE mandate where we will have that web-based, so we have completed that migration. From what I understand, it has gone really well. Just an update on our attendance, as you all well know, we have focused a lot on that this year, and it has paid off. Last year, our attendance was 94.1. This year, we ended the year at 94.7. So we're almost 1% increase over the last couple of years, so we're excited about that. And you know, what gets measured is what gets done. So we've been really focusing on that. Principals have really embraced that, so we're excited about increasing that. We have several teachers who are attending professional development across the district. The big things are the Land Foundation, or that grant that we got from the Community Education Foundation, where we're training student teachers over the summer, and also the springboard that the two middle schools are going to be implementing next year. There have been many teachers that's going through that training. We have some teachers who are going to the Behavioral Institute. So we've got a lot of great stuff going on this summer with teachers. I just wanted you to put on your calendars that the Preschool Ready Fest is scheduled for Thursday, August the 2nd. It will be at College Park. I will continue to update you on that. And also, we're expecting a K-prep assessment results sometime in September, but I will give you an update on that, and we'll know a little bit more about that. The state updates, not a lot that's going on except with the training with SIPs, just training all over the state with that. Also, I sent you all out earlier this month that KDE has decided to kind of hold back on the program reviews. We got a lot of input and feedback across the state that was just too much. And so we are going to be implementing that in baby steps rather than giant steps. So we'll get more information on that. But it has pretty much been solidified that we will not be implementing all of those program reviews on next year. That it will be in stages. So we're excited to hear that. I'm sure our elementary schools are excited to hear that. So that's all that I have right now. Of course.
Holidays contract.
Learning and Instructional Services. Our spring lab results continue. We have our county day treatment results.
Hello. This is the data that we have for our students as they progressed from fall into winter and from the spring. When we finished the spring, we had six students in the middle of the sixth to eighth grade range and tested with us. Some students were in different placements, residential facilities, and these types of things. The students who were currently with us at that time, it was in February 6th, as you see from fall, half of our students met on grade level in reading, and through the winter and into the spring, we finished with three students. They were different students. The demographics broke out the same, but they were actually different students. The one thing that we saw an increase with our focus on attention was we put a lot of attention on math, and we had a lot of interactive tools that we used, technology, smart boards, iPads. We purchased and tried to have a one-to-one interactive learning environment for our students. And one thing we noticed with the math was with the six students that tested, zero of them that tested in August were on grade level. And when we took the spring test, three of them were on grade level. So we saw a progression with that. So still something that we want to get all six there, whatever the number is. But we're pleased to see that those three students did. One thing with all six students tested, through periods of time, through that, all of them did make an improvement. They did increase in scores. It's just so they did not have to increase to get to grade level. So that's on the page of this. Any questions?
Second grade going from 57 to 70, which I think is good. operate from 4867 and 2870 Martin Road. And sixth grade, 4356. And all the grades have made so math at this point, math looks like it gets stronger consistently over time. The gains are larger. And over 2 years, they've started at about the same point, either 30 or 40. When you look down at spring 2012, you've got two of them in the 70s, two grade levels in the 70s, one in 67, one in 61, several in 55 on up to 60. So they have basically gone from high 30s, low 40s, to up to 55 on up to 70. So that's the math data is very strong, and the reading data is strong perceptive for kindergarten at this point and over time. But I would say we've consistently made bigger gains in our math and in the reading.
We had a couple of principals talk about how when they looked
at their individual data for their students, they had so many of them that were right on the edge of being on grade level. Would you say that as a district as a whole, that we are right there on the edge with the majority of our students, that this, on average, our 60%, I would say it's probably about average, 60% of our students are at where they need to be, but would you say that we're right there on the edge with most all of them?
Those in favor of approving the 2012-2013 student fees for elementary schools, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. The motion carries 5-0.
Thank you.
And Ms. Thompson and Ms. Whiteside for the middle schools.
Your recommendation, Dr. Harris?
I recommend that we're approving 12-25 student fees on contract with Park Hill Schools.
The motion is in order. Motion by Mrs. Moore. Second by Mrs. Thacker. Other discussion? Those in favor of approving the 2012-2013 student professional fees on contract with Park Hill Schools, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries five zero.
Thank you.
And Mr. Ballhorn?
Explain to me part-time and full-time students.
We have these students that are out there.
In work, kids leave for work, say?
Other questions related to the MSP fees? Your recommendation, Dr. Harris?
I recommend you approve 2012 graduation student fees for the Park Hill Schools.
The motion is in order. Motion by Mrs. Thacker.
Second by Mr. Spock. Other discussion? Those in favor of approving the 2012-2013 student fees for the Park Hill Schools, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries five zero. And now we have the first reading of our policy updates from KSBA. And Ms. Griffin. Where do you want to go with this?
This is an update at KSBA, and most of your policies have been recommended by them based on any changes in the general session, in any KRSs that have been changed. They always send those to us in May for your updates from UC. And so all of these that you have in here have been recommended by the board, except we have a few in here that we have recommended, and we'll show you what those. First of all, I would like for you to look at policy 08122. And we want to pull that actually from your packet. It's not on your checklist, but we forgot to pull it out of your packet. That policy is still being reviewed and revised by the CAD and their middle school principals. So we're looking at that. It's not actually on your checklist to go back to KSBA, but it is in your packet. So if you will pull that policy 08122. The other changes that was not recommended by KSBA is if you look at 01.421. And that is a policy that our chair and I had discussed, and it does have to do with public participation in open meetings. And the changes are in blue. If you have any discussion on that. Remember, this is a first reading, so you can make any changes tonight that you want to before you would approve it at your July meeting. Policy 03.1236 was a change requested by the district. We reviewed all of our leave policies. This is emergency leave. And one of the things we found is oftentimes, emergency leave is something that you have allowed the staff to take. They have one day of that, and 3 days, I'm sorry. And so they can use it based on policy for different kinds of things, for one being under bereavement. And oftentimes, they can't use sick days, so we wanted to give them an opportunity to use emergency days. So we changed the wording to say death of a relative or personal friend, so that they are still still within their right per your policy. Any questions on that? The other one is policy 03.125. 03.125, that's a district course change. And what we did down here, we asked for it to state that an itemized receipt must substantiate any bill exceeding $2, just to make sure we have a transaction of that. And we took out the unless attending an activity, which you can see that. So we made that change. Make it much easier for us to track that. Any questions on that? And the way we review these policies is all the staff, they look at the policies within their purview, and then we discuss it as a cabinet, and to make sure that there's no financial implications aboard, and if it will allow the organization to be more efficient and effective. So the district also requested a change to 03.2233. And we changed the date on the additional unpaid maternity leave to April 1st so that it would coincide with our other deadlines on our April 1st date. So all our dates would coincide with April 1st rather than Sunday, April 1st, April 15th. And policy 03.2236. Same policy as certified is under the classified. Same thing that says for the emergency. And then same thing for classified. We've got classified and certified policies, and that's under the expense reimbursement. It's the same as the classified, where we just put an itemized receipt. The other district requested change is 03.28. That is, says that each classified employee shall be evaluated 2 times each year by April 15th. We used to do the evaluation 1 time a year, and those individuals who are doing the evaluation and the employees that have been evaluated, it gives you an opportunity to have that discussion twice a year rather than at the end of the year. So if there are any concerns, commendations, we can have that conversation for the summative evaluation.
What's the timing of the evaluation? So that first evaluation, when's that due by, and when will the second one be obviously due by April 15th?
The second one has to be done by April 15th. The first one has to be done sometime in the first semester between January and, I mean, between August and December. And then the second one has to be done by April 15th, which will give the district an opportunity to make sure that we follow all the other deadlines by notification of salary, reduction of staff, and all those kinds of things. The other district change was 04.312.
Has been
been something that we have tried to focus a lot more on this year, and so we wanted to make sure that we had a parent and family involvement policy. We did not have one per se in our policies. We did have a Title I involved parent involvement policy. This one, as you can see, is much more detailed. Update that, so it was more of a safety issue, and we wanted to make sure that was in policy 10.5, and we added that all visitors must have parental approval and provide parent photo identification prior to the visit. And all volunteers shall have a criminal background check on file before beginning their volunteer work. So that's all new language that we put in to ensure the safety of our students and our staff. The next district change was 03.288. That should be on the procedures, I'm sorry. Yeah, that is procedure. And that is classified employee evaluation. We redid that whole evaluation this year. It is more succinct. It deals more with the responsibilities of the employees. The other one we had with a checklist was pretty irrelevant to what individuals did. That will come to you next month for the whole certified classified evaluation process. Will come to you next month for approval. But we have to get this procedure changed before we brought that to you. And Scarlett and her committee has been working diligently on that. The next one is 09.15, AP.1. Procedure. Sorry. On the 09.15, AP.1, I want to delete the last line there. It said fees collected may not be carried over to the next academic year. We do not want to put our schools in a box. Sometimes there are reasons why they have to carry over the money, and if we keep that in here, don't want to cause them to be out of to violate more policy. So I think we just need to delete that, because what they do is at the end of the year, if they have carryover dollars, they always send us a plan or a proposal for how they're going to use it.
So we want to make sure that they can continue to use those dollars for their students.
Which procedure is that?
09.15 AP.21. That's the student fee waiver request form. By law, we have to have an opportunity for parents to get a waiver from any fees if they are identified as students that receive free and reduced lunch. So this is the procedure that we will give our parents so that they can fill this out, and all schools will know that those students can have those fees waived. We have it as a policy, but we didn't have a procedure. And then you have the Booster Club, 09.338 AP2. Stacy and I discussed this a little bit, and we wanted to delete on that second page of that policy, number 7. That's the same thing about the policy. And the last change that we asked for as a district is 09.42811AP.1, and from the Civil Rights Review, they wanted us to specifically change the wording of how we deal with notice to individuals complaining of harassment and discrimination. So we made that change, and that's it. Any questions?
I have some comments, Dr. Ferris.
Sure.
Let's see, I've got a couple of flags, so it's been taken a bit. Comment on, let's go to policies, 01.11, Gerald Powers and duties of the board. I noticed that we added some language about districts of innovation. probably need a little bit of research, and House Bill 47, that's 01.11, general powers of the board. The House Bill 37 passed, and the districts of innovation concept was approved. I haven't seen anything in terms of rules or anything like that from the Department of Education saying what these districts of innovation need, what they are to do. I think there's still a lot of debate amongst the educational community about exactly what's contained in that bill, what that bill means, and everybody's looking for KDE for some rules and for some guidance. So I would say until those rules and most of that guidance is forthcoming, we need to be a little bit premature about adding language to districts of innovation.
This was recommended by KSBA, so if you all want to take that back to them, then I can share that information. That came from your policy advisors, and they advised you all to make that change, that as well as they have probably all of the districts that they service. And that came truly from KSBA.
All right, let's see. 01.421, public participation of the meetings. While I understand the rationale for the changes here, I really can't support anything that's going to have any kind of chilling effect on free speech. I think some of the issues we have had with our comments portion of the board meeting, there are ways within Robert's rule of order to address these things. Rules can be set for public comment, much like happened in the January meeting, which received in a very limited fashion. So I would not support anything that would restrict in any way the dialogue between the board, the superintendent, and the community.
And that is something that was discussed with your board chair, so you all can decide if the board you want to approve that or not approve that. Don't get to vote on that. So that's left up to you all.
The districts of innovation is also mentioned in 02.413. And then again, 02.4241, which is school council policies. So I'm not ready to ask the language for the 70% of the staff. It's not the district. So. All right, let's see. Family medical leave, there was a change.
Okay, before you go. On the schools of innovation, so Mike, do you, what are you?
I know that we are going to have to amend our procedures and policies at some point when these things do come to fruition. I would like to see what the rules promulgated by the KDE are going to be before we do that. So if you're going to change it now, you're going to have to change it again next year, when you find out what these things actually are.
Actually, this is your policy. If those guidelines come out, then that would probably be your procedure. That's usually how it works. So that's why they're telling you that you probably need to go ahead and put the policy in. And then when they promulgate the guidelines, then those would be the procedures. That's how that usually works.
I'd kind of like to see what we're approving first. We're kind of approving something that we don't know anything about. So I appreciate that.
This is generally the usual procedure that KSBA does based on the research that they do from what's passed in the assembly. You know, I think part of it is in anticipation of the things that will be coming. If districts do not accept the language that KSBA has presented this go around, then do those come back the next year? Do they, you know, let's say 170 of the 174 districts accept what they send, then do the other four districts get that back the following year along with all the rest? How's that work?
You would have to request to create a policy, which will probably have to go into procedures, which will probably come down in the next 4 or 5 months. Could be having a procedure and not having a policy. If you don't have a policy in place, it will actually tie your hands to start working on anything based on the District of Innovation, but you know, that's your call.
We really don't know what these things are going to be able to do.
Well, that, you know, they have the bill that was passed.
That's it. two pages long for the sake of it. The Department of Education shall do some things. Let's see, family and medical leave, this is policy 03.12322. So there was a change deleting for service duty for next of kin. And I was actually on the Department of Labor website this weekend, and I saw, when I researched that, I saw that next of kin just going to move on the Department of Labor's website. So I know that's a change that came from KSBA, so I'm not sure about the status of that. So I think we probably need to look into that and review that. On the second page, under restrictions, there are some changes there. I understand that the district wanting the employees to take any paid leave or other leave that they have. That's been common in the industry. It's illegal. I can kind of refer teachers that they are. Restrictions. The extended employees without any paid leave, such leave should be taken at your concurrently with family medical. Employees must use all available emergency leave, personal leave, and sick leave for being eligible to pay FMLA, except that the employee may request reserving 10 days of sick leave.
So what did we change?
I would like to leave it the right now you have it just sick leave. So you're going to force someone to use emergency leave, personal leave, and then everything. I just threw that out because, I mean, the way that I'm not sure how to reword it, but I think you should reinforce the policy that public property is used for public business and private property is used for private business.
I agree totally. That was a KSBA's recommendation, and actually, we asked her to change it, but she missed that.
Those reasons. impetus for that was reimbursement of the district, and at one point, cell phones were probably pretty expensive. I don't know if you remember the ones that you carried around that had the receiver and the phone there.
But those were pretty pricey, but cell phones have become quite reasonable now. So I think the impetus behind that was from an tax write-off standpoint, which is why they got rid of it.
So it's not having to bring your
car to the tiller. Okay. Modification. I guess you'll tell me which line.
Once the bill is approved, district-owned communication devices shall be used primarily for authorized district business purposes. You know, with the changes they have there, and you won't leave it. District-owned communication devices shall be used for authorized district business purposes.
Only thing is what Dr. Kudak said, in person.
Wherever possible, district-owned telecommunications devices shall be used for authorized district business purposes.
Okay, so changing primarily to only. Mm-hmm. And taking out the however occasional personal use section. What's the bill?
I can say that's what you want, and then work that way, bring it back to the
Google on the labor at MLA.
Two. Two, two, three, three, and two, two, three, six.
Hold on one second. I'm trying to page down. Where it has next to him.
What's the last one?
03.223222.
You all can change it. I'm not sure if KSBA, I'm not sure what you want KSBA to do. There are your calls and you can change it. I know what is it you want to do.
Department is clarification between KSBA and Department of Labor. Which one?
Safety with athletics, and this is a change of
things that pertain to concussions. A lot of the things that are in here were mandated by one of the, looking at the issues with concussions. So, the very last line on our concussions, student athlete deemed to be concussion not be permitted to participate in any athletic practice or competition during the day of an injury, or unless the physician provides written clearance, participate in any practice or athletic competition held on the subsequent day. It's a little bit loose in terms of who determines whether somebody has a concussion or not. And the way this is supposed to work is on the first day of practice, the athletic trainer who's there is supposed to administer one of the many standardized concussion tests that are out there. And the athletes are encouraged to do as well as they possibly can on those tests, which test neurocognitive function. And if they get injured during a game and something happens, ideally the trainer should be there to re-administer that same test, the very same one they got on the first day of practice. Yeah. Questions right, score as well or close to as well as they did on the first day of practice, and they're not concussed, they go back in the game. If the scores are lower, then they need to stay out. And current medical research indicates pretty strongly that concussed athletes are at risk for brain injury only if they go back or participate in the activity that put them at risk in the first place. So just wanted to make some comments on that. So, doesn't really say in here who, you know, how do you determine if somebody has a concussion or not. Who's going to be the person that you have positioned on the sideline now, but the athletic trainer is supposed to be the person who decides. So there's some breaks in the department. So again, I know this is a KSB policy, and maybe some further clarifications coming up. But any comments on that, Rupon? As this reads, anybody who's concussed, that's my patient, I'm going to have to see in the next day. So, you know, think for mild concussions, that might be a little bit excessive. For severe concussions, not at all. You can see what's being. Policy 10.31, which is parent and family involvement. I just wanted to put forward Dr. Harris and Elaine, Dr. Harris and Judy for creating this policy, including this policy. It's been long overdue for our district. The one issue I would have is with definitions in terms of parent. So defining parent, in my medical practice, is difficult. So any natural or adopted parent, guardian, foster parent, in case of divorce or joint custody, go by. There are grandparents out there who are rearing their children that are not legal guardians. They're functionally as a parent, but may or may not have that legal status if the child is not physically fit or removed from the custody of the biologic parent. There are a lot of gray areas there. So, and I would advise that some of those gray areas be revisited, particularly the one with joint custody. Practice sometimes we will have one parent that says we want things one way, we have another parent that says we want things another way. And if they have joint custody, you're in the middle. And I have a proper meeting between the two parties to see if we can find some common ground. So you're defining parents, so I think you have to be careful how you define parents. So now I would suggest revisiting. That it says parent, you would think parent is parent, but you know there are many, many gray shades of the term. So.
But in the joint custody situation, hasn't a court determined?
It says both people have custody, and both people have equal rights to make decisions for the child. Mm-hmm. So, as policy is good, but it's not. That's a mine that is going to be stepped on. So I think that needs to be addressed. While you're writing policy, while you're just writing policy.
It's a part of the joint custody.
It needs to be defined. Yeah. A little more clear.
parties that have children, but sometimes the parties that have three is what matters. Definition. So it's raised what time actually is sometimes.
Right.
The more precise that is, the better. Including the music there. I spend a lot of time on that during the school year. Close to 5,000 kids.
Okay, procedures. First procedure, 07.1811, food allergies.
Before we mention that one, on the other policies that involve the word parent, do the same issues apply?
They're having an ARC meeting with somebody, and there's joint custody of parents.
We've got parents in many, many policies.
You need a policy that defines your parents. And then the hospital's policy and policies are dead. We're going to try to sell the facility, but there are conditions that we have to have.
I don't know if Mr. Kern might be on whether you're going to try to help with that.
I think more definitely, more clarity between the joint custody issue and the parents. I can remember seeing news reports in other states of a parent not having being a parent, picking up a school kid from school, and they were not in our state, not in our district, we heard about that on the record. So I'm trying to think along the lines of more definition of a parent may or may not include the legal document.
I would start with this policy. I recognize that the situation is in the custody. So, if parents have joint custody of a child, both have equal rights for this policy.
That's a good one to do that. But that's not an issue.
But that's not covered in the very first definition, in natural or adopted parent of a child.
Sometimes in sometimes courts will not grant one person has custody of the person or the decision making of the person.
But what I'm saying is they're not both natural parents.
They have natural parents separate. Lots and lots of different things. Certain foods are being are being weighted, which not necessarily allergies, I guess it's preference of the child, but this is still can't handle certain foods, so. So I would strike that second line. I think if you say provide food item services and no substitutions for students based on that, it would be one conversation.
So is that, I guess part of what I'm looking at here is KSBA is saying or implying that their proposed new procedure reflects the most current federal and state requirements concerning student dietary needs.
And I understand that, you know, it's, you know, dietary, and not everybody can have, you know, offer us something for breakfast, but I think I guess the same for certain kids with certain issues that have more motor dysfunction. I think a lot of kindergartners frustrated or second graders who can't handle foods of certain textures.
So does provide food item services and or substitution for students based on medical needs?
I would just leave it at that. I, the issue I have is the menus are not the modified based on personal preferences. Somebody can say a child has preference or sort of strong preference for protection of another, you know, all medically legitimate, you know. Oh, I just write that second.
I'm okay with it. If I do not have the second sentence, I'll have it. Anyone else?
I think overall, also I thought the policy was quite good, and hopefully that will serve men. I saw somebody had addressed the bill, addressing the allergy and treatment of classes in schools, which didn't pass.
Who's responsible? Is that, or is the board responsible for that? Is the principal responsible for that? Who reviews that data? Who looks at it? This is an issue where there could be some improprieties. So.
Exactly what's being discussed, or even if we agree with it.
the terms of all this success. Do you understand, Mr. Rosenthal? I mean, I know you're not voting here. Can you advise us on the appropriate process for dealing with the first reading based on the concerns with...
What is the number of this last?
Many of these policies will need to be enacted before school starts, because that's what governs how the schools and students will operate.
How about if we pull out all the ones that we've talked about, approve all the other ones, and then talk about each one individually, and then like, well, and then see if we can approve on the group or discuss each one individually, and then if we can make changes to those or tables. That way we can at least get some of these through.
Procedures was 7.1, 8.11.
I just had a policy list.
Okay.
7.1, 80.11.
Some kind of order in your board meetings? I agree with that. There are Robert's Rules of Orders. You can say set rules for public comment session.
And that's what we're trying to do with this policy.
But you, I mean, you can set some time limit, you know, so. I'm not even disparaging, critical. I'm doing a poor job up here, I'm doing a job, I'm on the reason, be critical. Well, this table will be critical, but they're going to be critical, that's fine.
As long as there's evidence that it's true.
I vote for it away, and I'm not taking the task for it, I'm not criticizing, so. Part of the deal.
Let the board members have comments regarding 01.021, and the changes.
I asked a question, is this policy a conflict of interest? I'd like to do that, yes, one more discussion before. Yeah, if you want to say so. This is the one that I had, what's the one that's legal that I called for, I voted on this one.
Discouraging remarks.
There wasn't a lot of opinion.
We'll get to that, though, the other thing is going to be whether or not you're going to allow an employee who has received a credit promise to report back. I think we all have to speak back. I think there's a difference in effect of public officials and employees and the way that they're treated to. I mean, you probably have a final decision on this, but I can see where probably can be critical of an elected official differently than an employee. Because they're going to vote people out, but if you're an employee, I would think that we need a better definition for it, but we need that too, because a lot of people are critical, discouraging, maybe very, very fine. I understand what you're trying to do with more discussion, but I think there are other ways of polishing it. People who have critical remarks to put them in writing, we have procedures for dealing with employees that are more private than the public people.
My intent is not to allow people to come up here, you know, screen names and just, you know, yell at them, and that sort of thing, but, you know, there needs to be a dialogue between.
And I think we all agree with that, that, you know, at times it hasn't been, you know, right. Sitting here, it hasn't been that way. I don't want our employees to come to these board meetings and feel like they're being attacked. And that includes the superintendent. You know, we're doing an awful lot of good work in this district, and it gets to a point that when we come to these meetings, instead of talking about the good stuff, we have to start the meetings with this negative energy that changes the entire atmosphere in this room. And it gets old. It gets really, really old. And the amazing things that are occurring in this district get pushed aside.
I understand that. There's different ways to approach that, which will restrict the issues.
And how, what would you change? How would you change this?
I would strike, you can leave disparaging, but I would strike critical.
Just the critical comments after the district line?
I think that would be a start. Like I said, I don't like the way this was written. So. And I'm fine with, particularly if there are, and I'm fine with the way this is written, as for the district employees, but if you think city or read the policy, it's just for the district.
Well, and you know, I'm fine. You can say whatever you want about me. That's fine. But I don't want people to say things about our employees.
I would agree with you. As written, I think this hampers the dialogue. You know, I'm not sure how to reword.
Mm-hmm.
We have a 45-item agenda tonight, and we are on number 12 and 2 hours after we started. How long are we going to be here? If we have the public part of the meeting to be at the back and forth dialogue, we will be here very, very late at every meeting. The public comment period to receive input, I support that. But much of what has been presented during the public comment period over the past several weeks is not for the purpose of getting dialogue in an appropriate setting. And we can continue what we've been doing and what we're allowing folks to do, and that will compromise the good things that are going on. The policy is the negative energy that has been called out. Yes, we want our public to comment. And I think all of us have the dialogue with our public. This is not the only way we meet our public once a month. We are involved in many, many things that help us engage with our public. But the back forth during a board meeting, I will not be in favor of, because, you know, we have people who come, they want to listen, they want to engage in what we are doing, not what we are saying. And to have them stay late and late and later to get to the business of what we're doing, while we address matters that could be addressed differently and probably more effectively.
Well, I'm interested in hearing what people have to say. There are times where, you know, there's stuff that comes up at public comment session, like, maybe you should, you know, put a sign for Shearer School. I had no idea that that was part of public comment that educated me, and that, you know, maybe we're involved in that sort of thing. That's one example of how public comments can be involved.
Yes.
And put up.
Story very effectively and without bitterness or challenge. So, you know, I'm open to changes in this public participation of the meetings. We modeled it after the state of health affairs, and I worked on this. We modeled it after some other districts' policy. If others can do a better job with it, I would be open to considering that. But I think it's, I think what we have here is appropriate. So does anyone have suggestions about this policy? Does anyone want to vote on this policy? Does anyone want to change this policy? Or do we leave it among the ones that we're setting aside?
But Dr. Goodak mentioned three of the speech that's sticking in my head. I understand come up here and say something about elected officials. I've been 4 years up here. I've heard of everything in 4 years. But when it comes to an individual that is hired by the board, whether it's the superintendent, the attorney, or an employee that's as an employee of the district, then, you know, that's, you're singling someone out. And that's crossed the line to me. But at the same time is freedom of speech. I have constitutional rights. I can come up here and say something about me all day long.
Freedom of speech at public meeting is not necessarily the question of the board doing it. I don't have anybody to speak, period, about anything. So the board can set rules as to what public speakers say at its meetings.
Now, we provide for that. Members of the public may address the board during periods set aside by the board without submitting an item to the agenda.
It used to be you had to submit. We changed that about 6 years ago. 8 years ago when I came on. You changed that. You used to have to submit what you were going to say, and you had to submit.
7 to 10 items.
Yes, you had to submit what you were going to say. You changed that. And now you just come walk in and sign in and state what you were going to talk about.
Mm-hmm. And not even talk about that.
What is that?
So that it's a little bit more open.
And I've said that as long as folks have signed in by the time the meeting begins, they may speak rather than having to figure out 10 days ahead of time. Okay, so we pull that. Okay, next.
1.5, goes with district organization. There's a set of them. 2.413. 2.4241 is
I'm okay with the legal changes that KSBA has made. All the ones related to business information.
What's the O3?
O3.
Is that family?
Yeah, that's family. We're going to take that out until we get back.
So 0.11, 0.15, 0.2.413, 0.2.4. 2.103.1.0.3. That's it. Those four are the ones, districts of innovation, that we will vote on separately. That motion is in your motion. A motion by Ms. Acton relating to the four listed policies, second by Mr. Swob.
These are the districts of innovation policies.
Yes. And that motion is to accept the wording as presented by KSBA based on their legal research. So based on, this will be a vote on the first reading for the four listed policies for districts of innovation. Motion by Ms. Acton and second by Mr. Swob to accept that wording. About the discussion. Those in favor of accepting the wording from KSBA for those listed motions for district related to district innovation, say aye.
Aye.
And those opposed, say no. The motion carries 4-1 with Ms. Acton, Ms. Hicks, Mr. Swob, and Ms. Wolf voting aye. And then with Dr. Fudan voting no. So we're leaving. Any preference on what to do with 312, 322, 31, 321, and 10.31? Are we leaving those pulled out for further clarification?
Well, the 10.3.
That's the family one. That's the parent.
I thought we were letting that pull out for definition.
What about the other two?
Approve on first reading the remaining policies.
A motion by Ms. Thacken, second by Ms. Bull. Other discussion? Those in favor of approving the policies on first reading except for those identified, or those we are keeping, you have a list in your, I have a list here as well. Those in favor of approving the remaining policies on first reading, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. The motion carries 5-0. And I'm still not sure of what we're doing on these remaining motions. I mean, these are my policies, but we're going to get clarification on all of the above. And when we approve the others on second reading, these will be considered again for first reading.
And then do we have to have a special voting and done by some time?
See what they are, see if they would impact the function and operation of the school, so I have to check to see what the cause of that.
And now for the procedures, agenda item number 13. Approval of the procedures except 07.1 AP.11.
I'll be okay with that if you just strike on the second page of that. Item number one, provide food, item services, and other substitutions for students based on that we need. And then strike, menus will not be modified based on the first part.
That's the second sentence of item one.
Correct.
Okay. Are you all okay with that? Okay.
Make a motion to approve the procedures.
Okay. Motion by Ms. Thacken. Second by Mr. Slug to approve the procedures with the change on 07.1 AP.11 as indicated, removing sentence number 2 of item 1 on the second page of that procedure. Those in favor of approving the procedures say aye. Those opposed say no. The motion carries 5-0. Now, the procedures do not require a second reading. So those go into effect. Yeah. Thank you very much.
I've seen something wrong and thrown out, but if you consider our policy or our role, we do many important things, but the policy is
yes, that's important. That. Thank you. Yes, absolutely. Yes, it is. Okay. Consider approval of the 2011-2012 classified evaluation plan. Ms. Collins.
The purpose is to, like you said, to get more in-depth evaluation and address more issues we have that we have seen to be ready.
And continuing for the, well, I guess, ask, and I do. Is this the last? No, you still have another couple of minutes.
Certified evaluation was really completed last year, and so we're making that this year to make some revisions and updates. The major change, the only major change is that we implemented, which we had a subject evaluation due date, May 15th for 10 teachers, April 15th for 9 teachers, and we changed above the May 15th, we have the April 15th for all. All the summatives must be done on April 15th for all of them. So that is the major change. The other thing, we did an update to the professional role plan. The teachers are in their stage of development next to the art project, of course, they just said to make the easier thing to use it that way. And we just basically took out observations on the administrative, more conferencing.
Questions regarding the certified evaluation plan? The recommendation. Those in favor of approving the 2012-2013 certified evaluation plan to commence, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries 5-0. Thank you. And then continuing. Rosa Falls, the last.
let you begin and thank you for your service. And now, Mr. Christie, with the elementary schools handbook.
Our handbooks. And the changes at the district level were the same in each of them. We updated the notice of non-discrimination as required in the law, and with their wording. We put in the where appropriate within the school lunch prices that were approved at the last month meeting. Fees that were updated, I think they're already in there. We'll go back and double check those and make sure they were approved tonight. And then all the handbooks, we see the bullying, hazing, policies. We listed them as some higher handle board, the anti-bullying procedure board, the policies are listed in each of the handbooks and wording is the same now.
Is that new?
It's new that we put in the entire policy.
But it's on how one, it's the time.
And also, we see the disagreements, we see the 956 and section 504 printed in there, and how the entire handbook is the same wording, the board policy is the same. In the past, they've all had portions of those, and then So this year, we get them all, they're all the same. And any other changes that might be occurring in the handbook, I have to defer that to the principal. It's about to get these other particular policy changes. We did not make those changes in the training changes for it. If you have any questions about those, I think that's what I recommend to you for that to get them.
Who is representing the elementary school level? Is that still you, Ms. Hoffman? Would you all have any changes related to council decisions?
No, I think it was just the wording on page 8. The principal student and under organization for instruction, they added to best meet the needs of the students in that school. It's really not a council policy, it's just a best practice. They also added on page 11 the school bus system, which is new, where parents can online pay for food votes. They did go ahead and add all the fee policy so that parents will realize that there is a waiver of fees. It was kind of buried in there. We want them to be able to see that policy. They also, on page 12, included accountability and testing and updated the pay practices of the CTE. And then that, they gave it the definition of university training. Also, under policy intervention, they referred to the universal screener in the RTI process.
Under the dress code, the change about the footballs, is when worn needed? Or tend to trip and fall when wearing the footballs when worn? Okay, can we take that out before it gets printed?
And that's really not a dress code policy.
Do middle school parents have access to any campus?
have anything on the index page. Can you do it? Can you do it? Can you access it for, is it going to be something you can use for grade school too?
What parent board?
I'm not worried about her.
Middle school?
I don't recall, there's so much.
It is right there, the report card. Says parent portal is accessible. But it doesn't.
It doesn't give you directions.
Exactly.
Well.
I think Jennifer Wimmer would be a good person to do that for us, because you know, there's some changes this year about students having access also. I know she came and spoke to our parents at the end of the year and wants to come back at Alton House, so maybe she could help us with that.
Teacher access.
About the treatment. comment from the board?
My motion is in order. A motion by Mr. Slo, second by Ms. Moore. Other discussion? All those in favor of approving the 2012-2013 debt treatment program handbook as revised, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 5-0. And continuing with the student conduct.
Again, same changes as was previously.
Any questions regarding the code of conduct? Your recommendation on this?
Recommend that we approve the student code of conduct handbook with the necessary amendments.
A motion is in order. A motion by Ms. Moore. Second by Ms. Heck. Other discussion? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. A motion carries 5-0. Thank you. Consider approval of the, thank you, Mr. Christie. Oh, do we have the GRC handbook? Okay. The KEDC membership agreements.
The KEDC membership agreement and the state good news that fees are waived this year.
Questions regarding the KEDC membership?
We like the room. We like the room.
Your recommendation, Officer?
I recommend that we approve the 2012-2013 KEDC membership agreement.
Motion is in order. A motion by Mr. Slo. Second by Ms. Heck. Other discussion? All those in favor of approving the 2012-2013 KEDC membership agreement, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. A motion carries 5-0. Thank you. And continuing with Mark, guest pro and contact.
To receive their first offer of assistance for the head of the quality committee in the amount of $2,062.
Questions regarding the head software system? Your recommendation of parents?
I recommend that we approve the head software on the fiscal year 2012 head software system about $62 for up to 3 years.
A motion is in order.
Motion.
A motion by Dr. Goodin.
Second.
Second by Ms. Moore. Another discussion? Those in favor of approving the fiscal year 2012 head software assistance in the amount of $9,162 over 3 years,
aye.
Opposed, say no. Motion carries 5-0. Thank you. Community education grant assurances. Questions related to the grant assurances. Your recommendation, Mr. Harris?
I recommend that we approve the school education grant assurances.
My motion is in order.
Motion.
Motion by Ms. Heck. Second by Dr. Goodin.
Further discussion. Those in favor of approving the community education rate assurance, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no.
My motion carries 5-0. And the extra, the high school extra service salary schedules.
Changes because the additional payments to the today's bill.
Your recommendation, Mr. Harris?
I recommend that we approve the high school extra service salary schedules.
The motion is in order. Motion by Ms. Patton. Second by Ms. Smith. Other discussion. Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. The motion carries 5-0. Thank you. And continuing with their,
health department contract.
Including the health department contract, such as by men, including the narrative, have provided some of the changes in their rationale.
It's a need to ask. I think it's fine, any injuries, that's the market.
Your recommendation, Dr. Harris?
I recommend that we approve the 2012 interrupted contract with the Parks and Health Department, $27,500 for nurses.
Thank you. Any motion is in order. My motion by Dr. Cadet?
Second.
Second by Ms. Smith. Other discussion. Those in favor of approving the 2012-2013 contract with the Parks and Health Department for nurses, the amount of $27,500. Those opposed, say no. My motion carries 5-0. And then continuing with the different contracts for the Clark County Health Department for employee physicals and other purposes.
These things have not changed.
Also, big time.
Your recommendation, Dr. Harris?
So we look for the county contract with Clark County Health Department for employee physicals and other services. Motion is in order.
I'll make a motion.
Motion by Dr. Cadet? Second by Ms. Patton. Other discussion. Those in favor of approving the 2012-2013 contract with Clark County Health Department for employee physicals and other services, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries 5-0. Thank you. Mr. Christie, back up.
No, it's quite the free this time. Sorry.
Now, first item on the year.
Capital outlay.
Capital outlay, replacement of storefront doors, those are on the gas end of the cafeteria on the backside. There's kind of a safety issue. And very difficult to maintain and address it. I continue seeing, we're having great difficulty keeping those built doors just in closing and partly so they lock. We have an aim out there, I missed the push button, to go on those door systems there. I have one for that, that train at this point is in bad enough shape, it won't accept additional holes drilled in it. More work. Request is to use the capital outlay funds so we can place the entire end of the hill in your way, in this storefront. The aluminum, as these have, when we're looking at, have drip, we have holes, we have water problems at the same time. Hinges on the doors are continuous hinges to the degree of smaller hinges. And that's longer lifetime.
Questions regarding that? Are there? Your recommendation, Dr. Harris?
I recommend that we approve the use of capital outlay storefront on the east west end of Park Middle School, amount $17,000.
The motion is in order. Motion by Mr. Sklub. Second by Ms. Patton. Other discussion. Those in favor of approving using capital outlay funds for the replacement of the high school storefront on the west end of Park Middle School, in amount $17,000, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries five to zero.
Next item is to consider approval of the memorandum of agreement between the Clark County Public Schools and the Clark County Geographic Information System, in amount $12,500. That's the same amount as the end of your package, no increase to that. We use these maps, you've seen them at various times, you've used them at the board level, we use them assisting tremendously in our request routes, if we're able to have those two systems together and do computerized routes. They provide us with maps and ISIT represent the district on that board.
There's potholes on that map.
And we're just getting ready to download them all new.
Questions related to the GIS, the memorandum of agreement with GIS? Your recommendation, Mr. Harris?
I recommend that we approve the runway between the Park and Public School and the Clark County Geographic Information System, $12,500.
The motion is in order. Motion by Ms. Patton. Second by Ms. Patton. Those in favor of approving memorandum of agreement between Park County Public Schools and Park County Geographic Information Systems, in the amount of $12,500, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries five to zero. Continuing.
Next item is to consider approval to advertise for architectural firms for renovation of current Gilbert Rogers Park High School and current Park Middle School facilities. The letter will be added in the paper to request better attention to architectural firms for renovation of the buildings to be addressed under the one we did.
We don't have an aid on this.
The last one we ran, the contract had 7 days. It's recommended that you run it a little bit longer, for a tighter time frame than 14 days. It's recommended that you run it out of the park and run it out of the 14 days.
Can we change the Rogers to Rogers in the advertisement? In the motion, I'll put the Roger or?
Second line.
On
the public notice page.
For architectural services for renovation of Gilbert Rogers.
This looks like what might be going to go in the paper. I'd like for Rogers, the library to say, look at Rogers.
You'll have the screen.
Submitted their actual proposal of the previous. overview instead of proposal.
But how else do we have without someone on board, we look at those things, we can determine what all is going to be necessary in renovation, you know, buildings. And the other, in the past, we pretty much know what we want to do. You can do a level of business and have them make the recommendations as to what we need to make that building suitable for us in the purpose.
So their letter of interest will include their suggestions for how to approach the renovations?
No, it will not.
Just that they're interested in doing it?
Their terms and background and their term. We can add as much to that as you want.
You can actually ask for proposals after you get the letter of interest. When you send for the letter of interest, you can ask them to also send proposals. The board was prepared to have proposals. I can look that in the past. Yes, we can ask for them to send those. So you can decide, we can change this to say that the Clark County Board of Education is requesting a one-page letter of interest with a proposal, or we can say proposals for our potential services. If you would prefer to have something a little more than just one-page letter of interest, and it will be just like we got last time. We get proposals from the contract renovation architectural services. We ask for proposals, and we can do that.
Because I'm just thinking that a proposal, especially if the proposal is going to be project specific and address the type of renovations company XYZ would do compared to what company ABC would suggest, whatever.
Well, what we can do is just create the same proposal criteria that we did for the contract, because we still have that, right? And those were proposals.
Yes.
Yes, we can do that.
But also, in effect, you know, talk about proposal. There's two factors involved here. One is we know it's at Clark Middle, getting renovated. But GRC, I'd like to know what funding is going to be involved with that and the time frame. Because, and you know, what they can do within a certain amount of time. So my understanding, as we talked about this, was both middle schools are going to be combined into current GRC as is. And that's a time frame of 10, 12 weeks, time school ends, and then the time that the next semester ends.
I think that's the brain architect on board. They will be able, I don't have the expertise to tell you what they can do in what time frame.
Yeah.
So once you bring your architect on, and they will be able to discuss with you what it's going to cost in the time frame by which they will be able to do that renovation, and they may have to do something creative. I just don't know. That's why we want to try to bring an architect on as soon as possible, because we're looking at the 2012 entrance date in 2013. So that's why we have to go ahead and bring somebody on board so you can have those kinds of discussions with the architect. Because I don't know what they will.
Other questions related to the enterprise? Or you all have had some questions with us and you want to see the letter of interest?
Application number six, program construction company to work construction services on the new elementary school.
concept. Your recommendation, all in favor?
I recommend that we approve pay application number six.
The motion is approved. Motion by Ms. Poole.
Second.
Second by Mr. Sloan. Other discussion? Those in favor of approving pay application number six for the Bell Construction Company for construction services for the Bell Middle School project in the amount of $702,709.30, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries five to zero. Thank you. And continuing with pay application.
Next is the pay application number 13, employee observation contract for resident service services for the new pool garage and water tower in the amount of $9,375.
Questions? Your recommendation, all in favor?
So approval of the application.
31.
Pay application number 13.
And motion is in order.
Thank you.
A motion by Mr. Sloan. Second by Ms. Hankin. Other discussion? Those in favor of approving pay application number 13 for the Bell Construction Company for resident service services for the new pool garage and water tower in the amount of $9,375, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries five to zero. Thank you. And continuing with pay applications.
This is pay application number 19, general contract to the building for the new pool garage and water tower project in the amount of $1,394,397. This one is literally everything in the building. It's literally everything going on in that building.
Yeah. Your recommendation, all in favor?
Approve of pay application number 19.
The motion is in order. Motion by Ms. Hankin.
Second.
Second by Mr. Sloan. Other discussion? Those in favor of approving pay application number 19 for the general contract to the building for the new pool garage and water tower project in the amount of $1,394,397.50, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries five to zero. Thank you. Continuing.
Next item is request approval of change order number 32. To upgrade room thermostats in each of the rooms, classrooms, other rooms at the high school, the new pool garage and water tower high school in the amount of $27,573.40, which would come from the contingency of the project. These were originally in the original plans for building. At the time, due to the uncertainty of the bid, plans came and everything, that after school humidity is the best indicator of comfort in building. Or looking at comfort and looking at controlling the HVAC systems, humidity numbers are more important than temperature numbers are. These, we give a readout to the actual humidity level in that classroom. Each individual classroom. It would be a good tool also in working with staff and looking at what open windows, open doors does to humidity level that room, comfort level that room, how it affects the HVAC systems. That's, I think, in the documentation, I think there was a picture of what they look at and look like. Or to be policy on these were established at a good time. And the unit costing in half, the cost allotted to the additional cost of living in pre-determined, so that's a second difference.
So on these options, which option is it?
I think it's the first option. Option number one. Yeah, it should have been. I don't have a lot of doubt.
See, Mark's not the last one.
less expensive file was option number four and option six. It's even less expensive.
It's higher, it was, it had.
How are these mounted?
The wall mounted.
Okay, the four is that mounted.
Oh, I'm sorry, number four is, it was, it was a kind of.
So is that why it's cheaper?
It's why it's cheaper, it has, we're deciding, we're going to see that, it's going to be computer monitor. And all with these also, in addition, made it with a monitor that in the room, through the computers, our maintenance. Sorry, so we'll be able to monitor those through the computers, so if there's a problem in an area, it'll be monitored then too. Another word, I'm sorry, it was. Yes, this is only architect and electrical contractor. Also on this, I think already, Shaq, Oscar, and Dave's involved in all the contractors.
So this is the right way to go, Mr. Shaq?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Your recommendation, Sarah?
I recommend that we consider, that we approve change order number 32 to upgrade the home thermostat associated with the New Jersey High School project.
The motion is in order.
I got a question for you.
Oh.
So we will receive a, another change order to credit us back to what we bid on?
Now, this is the difference between the thermostats that would have been installed and the ones that will be installed. This is a, difference in the actual price. The thermostats are like $40 more expensive to have the humidity sensors in them. So this is the difference between what was originally spec and what you're going to get now.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking, like, under the original bid, I was under the impression that the humidity sensors, they did not.
No.
So the original sensor, the original thermostat did not be clogged yet, is that understood?
That's correct.
Okay.
The cost, it would have been associated with those, and this is addition, in addition to that, made this upgraded sensor.
Thank you.
Make motion. Motion by Ms. Hankin. Second by Ms. Other discussion. Those in favor of approving change order number 32 to upgrade the room thermostat in the New Jersey High School project in the amount of $7,572.40, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries five to zero, thank you. Continuing with the uncivil soil.
This is change order number 2-1, the elementary school project. The uncivil soils area is in the area between the existing central elementary and existing high rise. Their playground was, that's where the new road, the new entrance into the new building will be. It's kind of yellow hollow in front of high rise. It is four test sites, and all four of them have the uncivil soils. This is a cost of $22,154 just for removal of the uncivil soils and replacement of uncivil soils. Now, and that's only in the road base. So, it's not taking in the whole area, that's in the road base, the road between the two buildings.
What's the definition of civil versus uncivil?
The action and water issue.
So we didn't really have a picture of what that's suitable and what it looked like, all of these were unsuitable pictures.
And they're not good with.
They were for it.
If you were out there, you would see water standing at 3 feet, 3.5 feet deep, you'd see water standing. I think part of that is because over the many, many years that there's been a playground in the mulch, it's been packed in there, packed every year. The soil steeper, it makes it where it holds water.
Other questions related to the soil removal and replacement? Your recommendation?
I recommend that we approve change order number 2-1 for the elementary school project.
Motion
motion by Mr. Schlub. Second by Mrs. Hatfield. Other discussion? Those in favor approving the change order number 2, item 1, for the new elementary school project for unsuitable soil removal and replacement in the amount of $32,154, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Motion carries 5-0. Thank you. The next item is the resolution regarding the appointment of Jill Palmer.
As you have the agreement, and this is a resolution that we have found in the last couple of years, and all those campers from 1945. Basically, what they did for us is in conference with our board attorney, oftentimes there are other personnel or other legal issues that there are more experts in, and we compare with our attorney, and they do letters and advisement on behalf of the board, and also work with our personnel, universal resource director, to ensure that we are staying within the legal rights of our personnel issues.
Questions related to the resolution?
This is something that I've had some phone calls on, and it's in my constituency, and the board has an attorney that we have hired. What is the reason for another hiring of an attorney? Or asking me what is the reason for the improvement.
Over the years, I've existed on every payment for this. I don't think I've had a raise in 14 years. I'm not asking for a raise. I decided long ago, because of the time the board members live in, the staff live in out here, administrators here, teachers, classified personnel, that if I were on a different IP schedule by the hour, what I would be receiving would be much more than what I do. So over the years, there have been developments within the law that require much more of my time. Issues have come up involving personnel that become more delicate and more time-consuming than anything else. Every time that I've had an opportunity, I've tried to work out every situation I can as quickly as I could, fairness to everybody concerned, whether it was, let's say, a student discipline thing, employee, individual complaints. It needs to go on, and what I mentioned earlier about the family issues that come up, it is. So, I don't mind talking about what I get. I get about $2,008 a week a month. Lawyers would normally receive between $180 and $225. I would imagine that I'm putting in easily 20-some-odd hours on the weakest months that I do. If I take over all the parts dealing with personnel, I know I say it's unfair because I've created my own situation. I'm happy with it. I think part of doing the pro bono work that I may do for the Board of Education is a public service type of thing. But I think it's unrealistic to think that I'm going to take on all the rest of everything we do for the same amount. Last week, I know I did at least 12 hours last week. I've done 5 hours so far this week. You know that doctors get paid. I'm not asking about that. But I think it's realistic to expect somebody to be involved with the personnel, particularly in light of the fact that the board itself is not involved with personnel. I'm the board attorney. There are some circumstances that could come up where the superintendent would need a separate attorney to do it. The work that the general law firm does, outstanding stuff on employees. But I meet with lawyers that come up with places that will never go anywhere. I talked to everybody in the whole school district. I talked to any teacher who wants to call me, any high school person wants to call me, any member of the public wants to call me. I'm open with any questions they have, as long as I'm affecting my challenge here in my claim in that circumstances. I'm willing to talk to anybody as much time as I can, but I think it's unrealistic to continue to do that with personnel, considering the intricacies of that presents. I will say that this has developed over just Dr. Harris's term. This has been something that's been developing over many years. You see the different regulations that exist in the medical profession. I get questions from everybody out here about different regulations and different things and the consumable time to do it. I'm satisfied the way I am right now, but I do think in the bigger picture, it's better to have somebody else doing the personnel issues.
Other questions or comments related to the resolution? Another matter for internal board business, also a public matter, just an announcement. The there's a meeting on Thursday at 6:30 at the Clark County Extension Office. There'll be public discussion about the configuration of the new elementary schools. So if anyone is invited to that, that will be 6:30 at the Clark County Extension Office. The next item is consent agenda items. Does any member have any questions about any consent item or wish to consider any of the items that were on? A motion is in order to approve the following consent items. GRC at FA Trip to St. Louis, Missouri to attend the National FA Student Leadership Convention July 15th May. GRC football team to attend football camp at PKU August 1st and 3rd. UG4 closeout document for the direct purchase order number DPO 07461. Clark County member of education PO number 11010067 for Shatner Associates for the new curriculum classroom. The 2012-2013 development on encouragement, the tax position report, the Clark County Motor Vehicle Tax Report, the Sheriff's Report, the monthly financial report, general fund budget report, notice of personal action, and to acknowledge the notice of personal action and authorize.
authorize payment of salaries and compensation. And motion is in order for the consent. Motion by Mr. Flood, second by Mrs. Moore. Without any discussion. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. Motion carries five zero. And motion is in order to adjourn to closed session for discussion of proposed pending litigation, Lucas versus Clark County Public Schools and others, and threat litigation against the Clark County Board of Education, KRS 61.810, paragraph 1, item C, to discuss litigation strategy. Motion by Mr. Flood.
Second.
Second by Mr. Cadet. Other discussion. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. Motion carries five zero. And we are adjourned to closed session, so I need a five, right? We will reconvene in closed session for the legal matter as presented.